the equation we are dealing with and the definition, the solution we are looking for.
So the equation is this is the derivative. We are dealing with the one-dimensional case. It's divergence form, second-order derivative. Then plus BT, BUT plus DV hat UT and CT UT plus the derivative of F of a function F called F1, then there is just function F G DT and plus the stochastic part is sigma T DUT plus mu T UT plus GT DWT. And this is one-dimensional meaning process. So we're dealing with one-dimensional space and one-dimensional meaning process. The standard assumption is that 2a minus sigma square are bigger than a constant delta bigger than zero, and all the coefficients are bounded by and they're very measurable in x, predictable in t and omega, so that the whole thing makes sense. And makes sense. Now maybe I will put the definition again here. Just remind you the definition. So the solution of this guy with zero initial condition and with zero boundary condition. So not bounded condition, but zero boundary condition. And some initial condition u0, we have u0 in L2 omega I. I is our interval where this equation is considered. We mean a function such that u is in h, both page h. And I will not remind you the definitions of these spaces. Solution is on zero capital T, although there it will be capital T will be any number, so we will be solving this equation of any T. I will not remind you the definition of this guy for one reason. You know there is such thing as Lyapunov stability criteria for ordinary differential equations. Lyapunov, when he invented this criteria, he was given talks at a seminar of Chebyshev. And he used to do this in the following way. Each lecture, he reminded what was given in the previous lectures. So then Chebyshev said that, now I know what stability in the sense of Lyapunov means. It's exactly the point where during the lecture, he can only remind what was before, not tell anything else. So that's why I will not remind you this definition. And UT is continuous, is a continuous function. Is an L2 value
continuous, maybe I will put I for a while. L to I value, continuous function. This Fn stands for function. I was actually asked after the lecture what this Fn is. You can add here almost sure for almost all omega. But actually, if you found the function which is only L2 with continuous for almost all omega, then on the remaining set of omega, just set U to be zero identically. And it will not change anything. Because in the next part of the definition, what is required is to be sure, to hold only almost surely. So continuous, and the continuity in L2 means that limit when t goes to S norm of ut minus us in L2 I is zero. This is strong continuity. And then the second requirement is that for any phi in C0 infinity, so-called test function, what we have, this probability that something is zero is for all t. And last time it was written, what is that? For all t, less than capital T, say, if we are dealing with this time interval, is 1. And what is here, you understand, you multiply the equation formally by phi and integrate. And you integrate by parts when you have phi here, for the following reason. Because ut, this thing, is assumed to be in L2. And then when you differentiate phi is test function nice, so it will be a nice function multiplied by function in L2, so it will make sense. Functions from here have first derivative in x in L2 with respect to omega x and t. Okay, so first observation is that the definition makes sense. Because it could be that what you write here is not defined, just you can require this, but well, so let's just speak about the stochastic part. The way to prove it for the deterministic part is kind of the same. So in the stochastic part, you will have integral from 0 to t, and then phi c by t d u s. S plus new t plus I didn't say S. I said that the coefficients are assumed to be bounded, but didn't say anything about f and g. And these guys are assumed to be F1, F, and G in L2, capital T. So these are measurable, appropriately measurable functions, so it's scalar integrable in omega, T, and X. And this is scalar product in L2 of I. So measurability
is required for this stochastic integral to be defined is satisfied. Now, for this integral to have to make sense, what we need, so-called quadratic variation to be finite. So let's compute this quadratic variation up to time capital T, and this is just the square of what is inside. Well, GS A2I square, yes. Now, question mark if it's finite or not. Well, let's use, this is scalar product, and you can use Cauchy's inequality. Anyway, it will be, this thing will be less than a constant depending on phi, and let's say bounds for sigma and nu, say us, norm of us square A2i plus norm of its derivative square A2i and plus g times this guy plus norm of GS A2 squared. So the integrand is less. And that this is integrable by just by assumption about our what we call the solution and by assumption on G. So the definition does make sense. And now maintaining this part of lectures is existence and uniqueness. I will state we will come to the proof of this theorem much later. So, but still the goal is to, so for any. Any u zero, which is a two, and I write everything for omega. It's functional on omega. F zero measurable, and with values in a two I. There is a unique solution in the sense of the definition, and for any capital T, and also for any capital T, what hold is that expectation of the soup. So our function is continuous in L2. So this soup makes sense. We take norm of T square in L2 of I. So this is a continuous function. So what we write here is makes sense. Then norm of U square, well, phase H1 to T less than a constant times expectation of the initial value square in L2i and plus I write it like that just not to repeat the same thing many times. This is the sum of squares of norm, this and that. Or if you consider this is a vector, three component vector, then it's even just with constant n independent of u. Actually, it will depend on the on delta, on sups, on the bounds for a, b, b hat, c, and nothing else. And
capital T, by the way, on capital T.
It does depend on capital T.
What follows from this theorem, and I will... Yes, uniqueness in this theorem actually follows from this estimate. Once you assume that you have a solution in the sense of this definition, when you can derive this estimate, then uniqueness is automatic. And even more than that, and what we will be using is the following theorem, which is will follow from this one, from the estimate. Another theorem is that let f t n f 1 t n gn, gtn. So we have a sequence of functions indexed by n, atn, btn, b hat, tn. In the proof, actually, we'll assume that there is no lower order terms, because by the time we finish writing all the conditions on the coefficient, the time is up. And they don't change anything. But still, let's do it at least once. CTN, it's not yet the end. Sigma TN, and finally, nu TN. The functions satisfying the same conditions as these guys with the same electricity constant, with the same bound, and also satisfy these guys also in the same two T for any capital T. And we suppose that that ATN, that there is a convergence when n goes to infinity. CTN and then sigma TN, nu TN converge to object without n for almost all omega TX. Omega T X. In about convergence of this data, we assume that F T N F prime T N G T N converge in L 2. Actually, both face this capital T to you understand what?
We look at object without.
Finally, assume that also U and I forgot U and zero. U zero n converge to U in
U zero.
I use zero, yeah. In L2 omega F and L2 I. Then the claim is that there are solutions of equations corresponding to these objects when you replace them with indexed by n, in particular with the initial data. And what holds, what is true, is that they converge in the first place uniformly in L2 minus UT squared in L2i, and also they converge in the null in W in H1 null.
square H, or phase H1, 2, T goes to 0.
You understand that this theorem doesn't imply uniqueness, because if you take the objects with n index by n independent of n and equal to the original ones, then once you have one solution and another solution, they're just not only converge, nothing to converge. Still goes to zero, no? But independent of n means that it's just zero. Okay. And the proof goes in the following way. I don't mean definition. What I do in the proof, in the first place, I write that let's assume that all lower order terms are zero. Then the writing will be shorter. And let's introduce Wn. Very bad notation. But okay, still n. As ut minus utn. Then if you subtract equations for utn and ut, you will have that dwnt equals datn. Actually, of course, you you can't subtract literally this equation. You should subtract them in the integral form. But nothing good. You subtract in the integral form, and then and this integral form will be equivalent to what I'm writing. I'm claiming that this function is the solution of this stochastic equation. When t plus f hat tn plus d f hat 1 tn dt plus, and then we'll erase this stuff. Sigma q n d w n t plus g plus g hat n d w t. This has nothing to do with w n t. The index is different. Where what? Where f hat tn is ft minus ftn, then g t hat n is gt minus gtn, and f1 is a thing which will contain the difference of, well, anyway, f hat 1 t is f1 t minus f1 t n, which is natural, and then also plus the difference of a's, because this is a t n, and we didn't have it, we don't have a t n over there for the initial. So you just subtract a t n d u t.
Good point.
And then there should be some sigma coming.
Let me dream. Yeah. And sigma t minus sigma t n times and d u t.
Probably right.
That's right.
This I checked. And by the way, there are two ways to write it. You can write it with ATN, and you can write it with AT. If you write it with AT, what you have, DUTN, and this is bad. Bad by the reason which you will see in a moment. So then you write it on for AN and sigma N, because then you have this guy, which will allow you to use the dominated energy state. So now the difference, this thing, by the theorem will be dominated by constant times the difference of initial values, which goes to zero by assumption, and norm of these functions. And let's say we take the norm of this one, which I just ignored. So the norm of in these are both ways.
So there should be an expectation there?
Yeah. Expectation is inside.
Is included and on the left hand side with the bold face H it's also.
Yeah. Is bold face H is norm. Okay. Is with expectation. This is L to norm with respect to omega t and x. So the norm in L2 of this guy goes to zero, and the norm in L2 of this guy goes to zero too. By the dominant kind of state, because this guy is summable to the second power with respect to t omega and x, and this goes to zero for almost all omega t and x. So the dominant is bounded. The difference sigma n and sigma are bounded. So by the dominant convergence theorem you get, once you write this correctly, with this correction term, you see that this holds indeed. Well, now that's it about the main step in proving this theorem. There are two steps actually. One is to get the a priori estimate, assuming that there is a solution. And the second one is to use Galerkin's method to prove that there is indeed a solution. And the first step to get a priori estimate is to use, to find, to show that Peter's formula is available. There is a very long story about this Peter's formula. The first person who proved it was Pardou. Where is my marker? Better to lose it because it will dry out. Maybe I don't know. Pardou. In something like 1975. He did it in an abstract setting in very many steps with the hope that abstract setting will be useful everywhere. And then it turned out that not quite everywhere. You better stick with stochastic partial differential equation. And then people realized how to do it easier for stochastic partial differential equation. Pardou was doing this for stochastic equations with constant coefficients, with coefficients independent of time. Independent of x, but independent of time. Why? French mathematicians quite often say, just generalize something for the sake of generalizing.
It turns out that if he allowed the coefficients to depend on time and omega, in his case they are independent of omega and time, then you don't change anything, but you get existing theorem for filtering equations. Just for free. You just don't change anything. Well,
then with Razovsky, we proved what Pablo proved in also utmost generality in 78. And the proof is much shorter. Much shorter and uses a formula, Eta's formula. Only uses this one. What is this? You think A minus B times A plus B. Right, but useless. So this is the increment. So this is 2B times A minus B plus A minus B squared. As for any increment, for forward increment. 2, because derivative, well, anyway, you can check it. And this turns out to be very useful. So if you want to prove that when you have a linear process, Tn times Wn plus 1 minus Wtn. And you want, so the approximation of stochastic interval Wt dWt. And you want to prove that it converges to W, or say maybe 2, Wt squared minus T, then you better use this one. You express this guy as this thing, which will give you a telescopic sum, plus the sum of increments, which you know what it converges to. If you do it differently, you know eventually to a result, but in quite a few, spend waste some energy. It turns out that this is the basic formula. The same formula we used with Ishman Dewand to derive Eta's formula for the case when it this process, it's not the WT, but the process with jumps. The only tool, this one. But the proof is such that the referee wrote that he couldn't get through the all details, but believes that it's that there is no error. Anyway, so now I will present the proof specified for this particular case, and which will give us actually more, it will also give us the maximum principle for the equations. Okay, so this is about this formula, and the second is the following. We are given H 0 1 to I processes value Vt, V star T for T bigger than 0. Why V star? It's from old tradition, actually. V is in space V between very old setting, partial setting, and our setting with Razovsky and Ishtan was that there is V, there is Hilbert space H, and there is V star conjugate of this guy with duality given by the scalar product in H. Let's get it, okay. I'm just explaining why we start. And into value, into my value,
function gt, which is these are all predictable.
As many.
We assume that expectation of the integral from 0 to capital T, the norm of Vt star in H1 to I plus the norm of Gt square L2 I. Dt is final. And the main assumption also we have a V0 V0 is in L2 omega of 0 L2 I. And actually, what I should have done is raise this second, because I don't know, maybe I will raise it now just after stating, writing down. assume that for any phi in C0 infinity I, what we have is that Vt times Vt in L2i is equal to Pv0 in L2i plus the integral from 0 to t phi V star S H 1 to I DS M plus and the stochastic integral part C GT A to I GS.
Yes.
Although in my notes it's T. For all t, bigger than 0, almost sure. By the way, there was also a question here. We assume that for any phi, this holds for all t almost surely. Can we take a set of full probability such that this holds for all phi and all t on this set of full probability? It turns out that you can once you have this, just because the stochastic integral has many versions. If you just define this, say, as difference of this minus this one, just define, then what you get before? You get before that it's for any phi, then it will be for all phi, for all t, and for all omega.
And if you... The phi t should be phi, the first one.
What's that?
The first phi t should be phi, right?
Yeah. Yes. Thank you.
How about... Yes, it's phi.
But it doesn't give much. It's just equivalent to this statement. Just because, again, stochastic integral has no, cannot be defined uniquely. I'm sorry, actually, I misstated what I want. We assume that this one holds for almost all, and this will be the trouble.
Well,
in the proof of
existence theorem, we are going to use the Galerkin's method, which will give us such equality only for almost all omega t.
And now we, the main issue of it to prove that Vt admits a good modification.
That Vt admits a modification which is L2 continuous, strongly continuous process. Well,
so we are going to do this one. And for the purpose of proving the maximum principle, we want to prove
not only Itta's formula, but also for the square norm, but also for functions of u, more general than just square.
For definition, in the following, introduce R, script R, I pretend this is script R, as the set of real value convex functions R of X on R such that R is continuously differentiable. Then it's zero, and its derivative is zero at the origin.
It means, by the way, that it's non-negative. If you have a convex function, 0, 0, and the derivative is 0, it's about the first. And the second is trickier, is that R prime is absolutely continuous.
Its derivative, which is R double prime, is bounded and this exists almost everywhere just because it's absolutely continuous, but so assume that it's bounded and there exists a left continuous function functions with which R prime coincides almost everywhere. And we are going to call this left continuous function with consensus just R double prime. Once I write R double prime, I always mean that this is we take a left continuous modification. But the main examples which we have been using is R of x is x squared, and this will be in the case of Itta's formula for the norm of the solution. And the second case will be R of x. Let me write just one. X plus square. And then you see that why left continuous, right continuous, and this and that. This function looks like that. It is zero up to the origin, and then goes like x squared. So, by my definition, the derivative of this guy at the origin is zero. Although, the second derivative. Although, it's not just defined. But in that defined, it can be less continuous. Then, you can take a negative part too, and but we're using the positive part. Then there is a theorem. I'm raising, actually, what is it here is pretty much what is here, but we defined in a special way. So actually, what we are doing is, all this stuff is called G, and if you multiply by phi, you don't quite see the scalar product in H1, but it can be converted. The following, under the assumptions which are stated, there exists a continuous there exists a continuous L to I value. FT adapted a function UT and a set omega prime in omega is the full probability such that first is that VT is equal to UT for almost all T omega T. So this is a modification. You can't expect more just because the assumption is if you change W, if you change V on the set of measure zero with omega T, this will still hold. It's the best you can. And by the way, so that this U is in H, not with H, zero, capital K, derivative. Yes, V, you see? V squared in this one is finite, so this is in both S H. Second is that for all omega is in omega prime, all phi in C zero infinity. And all T bigger than zero, we have the equation over there, phi UT L to I equals phi U zero, V zero, V zero. L to I and plus
just, no, but what is important is stochastic plot. Integral from 0 to t, v star s in h 1 to I, s plus square root of phi with the stochastic integral gs dws in L to I. Here's the take why it's all for all phi. Actually, this stochastic integral is well defined. And this guy is equal to this one almost surely for all t. This is the property of stochastic integrals in Hilbert space. That's why actually I could have said that the holes is that the right hand side is this one, the stochastic integral given by this one, but then for almost all omega. And now I'm saying that it's for all omega, but just like this. And finally, it's this formula, which will take r to the 1/2 of ut square in L to I equals r to the 1/2 of u0 or v0. U0 and v0 coincide if you take t equal to 0. You'll see that this holds for all phi, for all omega. U0 squared L to I plus the integral of function ht, hs ds, and then say what these are, ms. So let me erase this thing, but more or less nature of the phi, v's in h1, 2, not nature of that v is in h1, 2. But still, this is the one percentage. Where hs is the following r prime us, then v star s h1, 2, I plus 1/2 of r double prime to the 1/2. So you take double prime, take 1/2, substitute us, and then multiply by gs. I was afraid that I forgot to mention that it's bounded. So this guy is bounded, and this is in L2. Square L2i. And empty is the stochastic integral from 0 to t r prime us, the square term with gs in L to I dws. So this is the statement. Let's throw away phi. Not quite. First I want to show that this is a natural formula. If you say forgot it and you want to reconstruct it, then you can argue in the following way.
what is this current product?
This is so phi v star in H1 to I is actually the scalar product of phi and v star in L2 I and plus the scalar product of the derivative. Phi is a function with compact support, so I can rewrite this one as phi v star. So now I'm using this definition. That I consider v star as a generalized function. And then this is the action of this generalized function on phi. This generalized function is turned out to be just a usual function. And in the same way, this is minus phi d2 v star. Second order reduce of any generalized function exists. So this is not a scalar product v2. Anyway, what is here is phi times 1 minus d2 v star. So that if after that you treat all of these things as actions of generalized functions, you end up allowing yourself to factor out this phi, which will be ordered. And if you look at this theorem that you indeed can factor it out, then what is written in here is that dut is 1 minus d2 applied to d star dt and plus g dwt, nothing else. And this equation is understood in the sense of generalized function exactly by multiplying formally by phi and taking all functions as generalized functions. Now look what happens. V has only one derivative, usual derivative. So this one is indeed a generalized function. You integrate the generalized function with respect to time. This thing is in L2. What makes the right-hand side to be continuous in L2? You add, after integrating, you have a function in L2, add integral of generalized function, and why do you have it in L2? So then, what forces this to be in L2 is the assumption that dt is in H, in both ways, H1, 2, I. That actually you know a priori that this guy has a derivative in X, summable to second power for with respect to omega t and X. It's not continuous, but still has some regularity. So it has some regularity. This is a kind of bad thing, but by some miracle, the result is pretty good. So we can conclude that it is actually continuous in L2 only on the basis of this fact. Now, okay, so this is what we are going to fight with. But now, so I assume that we can use it as formula. Give up my thinking. So how to reconstruct this one? You just this one is r to the 1/2 of u squared, and when you have a L2, what you are dealing with r of ut. The integral of this guy with respect to x on the left. Well, and then dr
of u t is r prime of u t du t plus 1/2 r double prime of u t du t squared. It is formed.
Assuming that the differential usual, and actually this thing, it's kind of, it could be hard to multiply this guy by r of ut. You cannot multiply generalized function by a function, not a good one. And what you get?
Well, you know, let's dream one more. R prime of ut. Dut is this 1 minus d2 b star t dt. So this part of, then there is also another part with dt, 1 half r double prime ut g squared in dt, and this is all these terms with respect to Hamilton dt of the coefficient. And there is also r prime, the stochastic term, gt dwt. And now let's integrate with respect to x. And on the left you will have this thing. The integral of this guy, as I told you, is just the scalar product of this one and vt in h12. We just saw it. So then it gives you this term. This one is just rewritten explicitly, and this one is also over there. So no miracles, it's just no one. It is very, then the only trouble is to justify it. There is a particular case. To be honest, we are not moving in my lecture notes. Yeah, neither all this tell you something which I wanted to tell, but the right-hand side here is also a continuous function. Then the norm is continuous. And one knows that if we have in a Hilbert space a weakly continuous function such that the norm is continuous, then it's strongly continuous, and it's a trivial fact for Hilbert space. Right, the difference. But this also is true for in any LP. And in many, I forgot what the name, either U and D spaces, but anyway, in LP. So you know what? There are only 10 minutes left, and I don't think that I can be able to state, even state the corollary, later on prove it. So I stop here.